Hi, and welcome back to another Dr. Science video. On today's episode, we'll be talking about imprinting. I'm sure all of us at one stage or another have looked at our chromosomes and asked, why are some parts of it closed? Well, one reason may be imprinting. Imprinting is the epigenetic process of silencing genes. When you inherit chromosomes, some of these genes will be silenced through methylation, wherein methyl groups attach to the cytosine in DNA and lock it up so the genes that have been methylated cannot be expressed. Importantly, imprinting is sex specific. When you get one chromosome from dad and one from mum, they are imprinted in different ways. However, these imprints won't stick around forever. When it comes time for you to imprint your genes, they will all be imprinted in the same way as one of your parents, and which parent it is corresponds to your sex. To show you what I mean, have a look at what I'm printing. Before I print my chromosomes, you can see one has my dad's imprint and the other has my mum's imprint. But when I print them, both chromosomes have my dad's imprint, even though this chromosome still came from my mum. I only imprint in the same way as my dad because I am male. But if I was female, I would imprint in the same way as my mum. But does this make a difference to how organisms function? For that question, we have to go way back to 1991 when the paper Influence of Paternally Imprinted Genes on Development was published. It was written by M. Azim Surani and Anne C. Ferguson-Smith, who are Royal Society members responsible for discovering imprinting, as well as prominent geneticists Sheila C. Barton and Reinhard Fundele. They aimed to find out how paternally imprinted genomes affected development of mice embryos. They carried out the experiment by first transplanting androgenone inner cell mass, or AGICM for short, into normal mice blastocysts to create AGICM cells. These AGICMs only have paternally imprinted chromosomes, so the cell only had paternally imprinted genes. They were then grown in the presence of normal cells, which created an AG chimera containing both AG and normal cells. This combination allowed the AG cells to influence the growth of the normal cells, but also allowed chimera to be viable, as the AG cell-only embryos lack the viability of normal embryos. They followed a similar process to create gynogenone, or GG chimeras, containing duplicated maternal genomes, so they could compare the effects of paternally and maternally imprinted genes on development. The researchers then monitored how these chimeras grew. The AG chimera embryos had up to a 50% increase in growth, and the AG cells had a greater contribution to the development of the heart and skeletal muscle than normal cells, but did not contribute as greatly to the brain's development. When they looked at the GG chimeras, they found the complete opposite. The presence of GG cells led to a 50% decrease in growth, and did not contribute much to skeletal muscle, but did contribute greatly to brain development. They also found that AG chimeras rarely developed a term to be born, with the greater AG cell contribution often leading to an earlier death. Even the AG chimeras that did survive to birth either died shortly after birth or were runted with deformed chest. GG chimeras had better luck developing to term, with two mice actually living to become healthy and fertile. However, the other two GG chimeras died around birth. This death and deformity of chimeras confirmed that a balance of maternally and paternally imprinted genes is essential to healthy development. However, more importantly, this study was the first study to truly investigate what effect AG cells had on the development of embryos, and the discovery that paternally and maternally imprinted genes had reciprocal effects on embryonic growth was significant. This discovery elucidated imprinting's function of embryonic growth regulation for lineages, such as cell lineages linked to the heart, muscle, and brain. Although genes had already been found that connected imprinting to growth regulation, this study was among the first to definitively link growth regulation to imprinting by investigating cells with only paternally imprinted genes. These definitive findings helped to set up significant future studies, such as those by Kay Vern, that found further evidence confirming imprinting's important role in growth regulation. But that's all for now. On the next episode, we discuss the science behind creating a smooth end to your video.